I'm Emily Chang. I'm Emily Chang in San Francisco, and this is a special edition of Bloomberg Technology Ballot Breakdown. Coming up in the next hour, counting and recounting the votes. Biden has more paths to victory than President Trump at this moment, but with legal challenges to the vote in various states, the winner is far from clear. President Trump has already declared victory. Facebook and Twitter have flagged or hidden multiple posts by the president for being inaccurate or misleading. But while Twitter makes it impossible to retweet the tweets in question, Trump's posts on Facebook are still being shared tens of thousands of times. And it's a big win for the gig economy in California. Voters decide Uber, Lyft, DoorDash, and more don't have to treat their workers as full-time employees, a victory for their business models. We'll get to all of that and more this hour. Meantime, in the last half hour, we got word that Michigan has gone to former Vice President Joe Biden, according to CNN and NBC. And at this point, if he wins Nevada and holds Arizona, where some votes are still being counted, he will win the presidential election. But there are legal challenges afoot. President Trump's campaign threatening to sue over vote counts in Michigan and says it's declaring victory in Pennsylvania, where votes are still being counted. But first, I want to talk about the markets, which kicked off with one of the biggest post-election rallies in history. The S&P 500 posting its best day since June, the Nasdaq having its best day in months. Let's get to Bloomberg's Abigail Doolittle in New York. Abigail, with so much uncertainty, why are the markets outperforming?
You know, Emily, it's really pretty incredible because it doesn't make sense on an intuitive level initially, because investors, markets, businesses, they love certainty. We do not have that at all. So you think that stocks would be doing the opposite. They're actually trading as though they already know who the next president is. You have the S&P 500 closing up 2.2% off the highs, but as you were mentioning, the best day since June. In fact, three huge updates, the best three updates since April. So investors want in on stocks. However, Emily, beneath the surface, there are some nuances, one of them being that tech, this year's defense, it was one of the best sectors. So stocks like Amazon, Microsoft, Apple, those were the top six stocks. Interestingly, volatility retreated so much so that you have to wonder whether or not there could be some sort of reversal, the VIX having its biggest drop since March. And when we bring Haven bonds into the picture, Emily, this is really interesting because bonds had their best day since April. So the 10-year yield falling by more than 10 basis points. On the one hand, that has to do with the idea that there isn't a blue sweep. So the reflation trade that has to do with huge, huge, big stimulus is off the table. On the other hand, you have to remember, bonds are a Haven asset. So when they rally in this big of a degree, you can't forget that it is a Haven bid. So relative to the uncertainty we are seeing, we do have investors going into bonds. If the 10-year yield goes below, let's call it 74 basis points, you could have a real rally for bonds, which would point to this uncertainty that we're having, that investors want to hedge these big stock gains with those bonds.
All right. I want to quickly check in on Qualcomm shares rocketing up after hours after they reported strong results and a really strong forecast, one of their strongest in years. I actually just got off the phone with Qualcomm CEO Steve Mollenkopf, who told me that the growth of 5G has been great for them, that clearly this shows their strategy on the phone. Businesses like auto and IoT are working. In terms of uncertainty ahead, he talked about how their customer base is very broad geographically with different OEMs. So that means, he says, we can win 15 different ways. We also talked, of course, about the uncertain political environment. He said they're following it, but don't expect any big change in the political environment as it impacts Qualcomm. He said they're still feeling pretty confident. There's been a lot of political turmoil that they've had to deal with. And the one trend, he says, I've definitely come to believe is that connectivity and 5G are really important components and almost insulated from the things you see every day in the news. So some interesting commentary there, especially on the back of Apple CFO telling us last week that uncertainty was really the name of the game going forward. Talk to us about what you're seeing when it comes to big tech stocks today.
Well, those are certainly very interesting comments. So big tech stocks really rallying on the day again. This year's defense kicking into high drive as investors want back in on the winning trade. And perhaps what Qualcomm CEO was telling you there in terms of not expecting the political landscape to change too much, maybe that's a part of the rally, why we do have big tech stocks rallying. A big piece of the rally, though, today, though, was also healthcare, Emily, the best sector on the day. The biotech index at one point having its best day, going all the way back to November of 2016 after the election. So that's where there is some political change, because healthcare stocks relieved. Some analysts are saying that there's not a blue wave. And then there's Biogen, Emily, surging on the day, up more than 40%, its best day on record, on positive indications around its Alzheimer's drug that could really be a game changer. More information is needed, but best day. So healthcare and tech, those were the big drivers on the day. But again, those are defensive sectors, Emily. So stay tuned. More swings, choppy action could be ahead.
Absolutely. And I'm sure there will be more developments overnight. And we'll see how that affects the trade in the morning. Abigail Doolittle, thank you so much for that update. Now back to the latest on the election. Vice President Biden making a speech outside his headquarters in Delaware just in the last hour.
After a long night of counting, it's clear that we're winning enough states to reach 270 electoral votes needed to win the presidency. I'm not here to declare that we've won, but I am here to report when the count is finished, we believe we will be the winners.
Biden also projected to win Michigan and Wisconsin, according to various networks today, as he inches closer to those 270 electoral votes needed to win the White House. President Trump, on the other hand, falsely declared victory earlier this morning.
This is a fraud on the American public. This is an embarrassment to our country. We were getting ready to win this election. Frankly, we did win this election. We did win this election. So our goal now is to ensure the integrity for the good of this nation. This is a very big moment.
Speaking of a big state, Pennsylvania, I want to get to the latest there, the state we are watching now most closely. We are live at the Philadelphia Convention Center, where right now mail-in ballots continue to be processed. Mark Niket, our Bloomberg News reporter, is there covering the story. Of course, we know the Trump campaign has said they're also going to sue in Pennsylvania. Mark, what is the very latest on the vote count right now?
Well, Pennsylvania was probably the furthest behind the other states in terms of counting these outstanding mail ballots. We're seeing about a million still to be counted across the Commonwealth, and about 100,000, 150,000 still to be counted here in Philadelphia. The election officials say they're working around the clock to get the count done, but we still might not know a final result here for a day or two. But that hasn't stopped the Trump campaign. They're already filing lawsuits to stop the count or at least challenge the results on the basis of a number of things, including that their poll watchers weren't allowed to get close enough to inspect the process of counting these mail-in ballots.
All right, Mark Niket with the latest on Pennsylvania there. We'll continue to stay tuned to your reporting and follow the count as it plays out. I want to get over to the White House now, where Bloomberg's Jordan Fabian is standing by. Jordan, the Trump campaign has now threatened multiple lawsuits. Not sure how many lawsuits have actually been filed, but where do these threats stand, whether it's Michigan or Pennsylvania?
Well, they're just emerging, Emily. The Trump campaign just announced a series of suits that they plan to file in Pennsylvania about the counting of early and absentee ballots there. They're trying to stop the vote counting in Michigan over concerns that their ballot watchers didn't have access. And they're also looking for a recount in Wisconsin, where Joe Biden currently leads by over 20,000 votes, and where the networks have made a call. So the Trump campaign is going to need to have everything go in their favor if they want to pull this out, with those calls going for Joe Biden in the upper Midwest. And it's not looking too good for them at the moment.
So, Jordan, what are you watching right now?
Well, we have our eyes on Nevada, which is currently counting some votes. If you say that Arizona holds for Joe Biden and Michigan and Wisconsin also hold, Joe Biden picks up those six electoral votes in Nevada, and the game could be over even without Pennsylvania. And of course, we are still keeping a close eye on Pennsylvania, which has those 20 crucial electoral votes. If for some reason Nevada doesn't go in Joe Biden's favor, or if there's a surprise result and Arizona gets flipped into President Trump's column.
All right, Bloomberg's Jordan Fabian at the White House. Jordan, thanks so much for your reporting. As Jordan mentioned, we are still watching Arizona. The Secretary of State there, Katie Hobbs, was just on CNN talking about outstanding ballots. She says there are still 600,000 outstanding ballots in Arizona, so continuing to follow the situation there. All right, coming up, as mail-in ballots continue to be counted, false information continues to spread about who is in the lead. So what are the platforms doing, Facebook and Twitter, to prevent this misinformation ahead of a final tally? That is next. This is Bloomberg.
I've seen some of the stories that you're talking about around this election. You know, personally, I think the idea that fake news on Facebook, of which it's a very small amount of the content, influence the election in any way, I think is a pretty crazy idea.
That was Mark Zuckerberg to our Bloomberg contributing editor, David Kirkpatrick, shortly after the 2016 presidential election. 4 years later, the tune has changed. Facebook and Twitter have both flagged multiple posts and tweets from various political officials for misleading or inaccurate information, including many from the president himself. But there's a key difference. When Trump claims victory or that votes are being stolen, Twitter hides that behind a warning. They can't be retweeted. Facebook attaches a disclaimer to the same posts, but they can still be shared and have been tens of thousands of times. Joining us now, David Kirkpatrick, Techonomy founder. David, really good to have your historical perspective here.
Thanks,
especially. But what do you make of the way that Facebook and Twitter have been handling the president's posts just in the last few hours differently?
Well, there's a sea change since 2016, as you note. I mean, when Zuckerberg said that, I think he really believed what he was saying. Clearly, the evidence that accumulated in the months and years afterwards about Cambridge Analytica, Russian manipulation, and a lot of other factors showed that he was wrong when he said that. But I do think the companies, Facebook and Twitter as well, and YouTube too, have recognized they have a much bigger responsibility to police political speech, particularly around elections, than they used to think that they had. And so now we see them frantically trying to do a whole range of different things. And I think many of them are genuine improvements from the way it happened before. But the quantity of misinformation, disinformation, and frantic speech that is hard to judge whether it's true or not makes their job extremely difficult.
So let's talk about the president's latest posts about winning, about votes being stolen. You know, I believe it is intriguing that these posts can be shared on Facebook tens of thousands of times, and Twitter isn't letting them go any further. I mean, two completely different approaches.
Right, but they're actually being discriminating in different ways about what they label and restrict. So in fact, a number of the posts that on Facebook have a disclaimer statement attached to them are being allowed on Twitter to circulate freely. But a small number of posts on Twitter are being completely hidden and unretweetable, as you noted. But I find that interesting. The standards are different that the two platforms have. But I have to say, it's kind of almost amusing looking at Facebook, because the president has made this whole series of statements. It's kind of like, this loud and somewhat excitable kid on the schoolyard shouting things, and then this sort of Poindexter type very calmly and factually and unemotionally stating a fact. It's like you see, it's like a dialogue. The voting is still underway. The election has not been called, or that kind of thing. But the president's most recent tweet was quite amazing. He's saying that he claims the electoral votes of Pennsylvania, Georgia, North Carolina, and he said, I hereby claim Michigan. Now, everybody knows you can't just claim the electoral votes. It's a matter of how it ends up. And so for that post, Facebook had a very sober, votes are still being counted. The results of the election have not yet been determined. But Twitter hasn't done anything with that same post.
it's not just Trump that's being impacted by this. The chair of the Wisconsin Democratic Party is just one of many political officials who has had post flags. He claimed that Biden had won Wisconsin hours before the networks did. In the days ahead, given that the president has vowed to contest the results in various states, talk to us about what is at stake in terms of how these platforms moderate this conversation.
Well, an enormous amount is at stake, and for both platforms, but I would say particularly for Facebook, which, as you know, is the one that I've studied the most, writing a book about it, because Facebook for the United States is the predominant media platform. So it is very important that Facebook figure out how it handles this. And I think they have worked hard to come up with more methodical and reasonable rules, but they are also extremely loath to be too hard on the president. And I think that's been shown over the last couple of years. So they're trying to sort of thread a needle, but their hands are shaking. And I don't think it's very clear what they're gonna do. Clearly, they're not gonna just let any statement be made and let it rest. They will continue to put these sort of mild, rebuking, sober rejoinders on many of the president's posts. But unlike Twitter, you're not going to see Facebook, I don't think in most cases, and they haven't yet, actually completely bar any statement. So Twitter may end up barring more statements if the president goes further than he has gone, although I think claiming electoral votes is a pretty far cry already. Twitter might take more extreme action. I don't know. But they know they have big responsibilities as major national communications platforms to bear some responsibility for how their platforms are used. And they're just really trying to figure out, sometimes in real time, what that means.
Interesting. It is certainly a fluid situation, as are the results. David Kirkpatrick of Techonomy, always good to have you with us, David, and appreciate your historical perspective here. All right, coming up, a big day for Uber and Lyft after winning the California vote for contract drivers. What is next? We're going to find out after this break. This is Bloomberg. It is business as usual for Uber and Lyft going forward after California voters approved a measure called Proposition 22 to allow the companies to keep treating their drivers as independent contractors rather than full-time employees. Shares of both ride-hailing services surged as much as 20%, the most in many months. Joining us now to discuss, Dan Ives, Managing Director at Wedbush Securities. So Dan, being a California resident, I've been on the receiving end of all of the advertising for and against Prop 22, but either way, a big victory for both of these companies. What does it mean for their business models going forward, knowing they're both still suffering in the midst of a pandemic?
Yeah, I mean, look, this was a dark cloud over the gig economy with Uber and Lyft front and center. And from an investor perspective, it was hard even for institutional investors to really be bullish on these stocks, given you had the AB5 and, of course, the Prop 22 overhead. A massive victory. And I think this morning, Dara and team were drinking mimosas.
I'm sure they were having quite a party. You know, they will have to deal with the political environment, though. We are facing some at least short-term uncertainty here, not knowing who has won the presidential election. How do you expect this to impact markets? It was an up day today, but what about tomorrow?
Yeah, I mean, look, you know, overall, when it comes from a tech sector perspective, it was almost a Goldilocks scenario in terms of what we saw today, because if you think about no blue wave, that basically means in the eyes of the street, a contained risk for antitrust, which was significant. You saw many of the FANG names and large cap tech rally. And then if there's a Biden presidency, which looks to be that way potentially, that's viewed as a positive on the U.S.-China issues, because that's something that'd be positive in terms of the decoupling path for the likes of Apple, Cisco, and the semi-food chain. going to be volatile. But today, from an investor perspective, I think it was Goldilocks.
Meantime, we've talked about this, how this is a huge test for Facebook. Facebook shares today up more than 8%. Why is that?
They've gotten through the election with no black eyes. And you can't really say that for Twitter.
But have they? I mean, isn't now the most critical time given the post-election chaos?
Yeah, and I think there's still chapters to be written, but at least coming out of this thus far, I think investors are, you know, very pleased what they've seen, not just in terms of course, advertisers staying with the platform, but no silver bullets that were viewed as, you know, really some of the negatives that were feared going into the election cycle. They still need to, over the coming weeks and then over the next month, but just compare that with Twitter in terms of everything that's happened on that platform. And obviously it comes coming off a soft quarter as well. So I think for Facebook, but they also get caught up in the large cap tech rally, because I think based on what we saw today, I think FANG names rally another 10 to 15% through year end. And obviously Facebook front and center there.
So then it doesn't matter who's in the White House? You think that'll happen either way?
Look, I think from a street perspective, no blue wave was viewed as bullish for a number of reasons. And obviously a Biden or Trump in the White House, I think from a tech perspective, it's viewed now that at least antitrust is a contained risk. And it's something where, from a tax perspective, a lot of questions have been again for names like Apple and a lot of the large cap names. You know, what's the implication of the potential Biden tax plan? And I think that's viewed right now as maybe more in the background noise, given what you see in the Senate. So that's why you saw the reaction today. But as we know, you could continue to see volatility. But for tech investors, when they woke up this morning, I mean, it was a pretty bullish sign that I think stays, throughout going into year end.
All right. Well, we are following every twist and turn. Of course, Dan Ives of Wedbush Securities, always great to have your perspective here. Thanks so much for sharing your insights with us. Okay, coming up, as the battle for the White House continues and the race too close to call, we're going to hear from a California representative about her top concerns and priorities. Representative Judy Chu joins us on the back of her resounding re-election next. This is Bloomberg. Welcome back to Bloomberg Technology. I'm Emily Chang in San Francisco. Joining us now to talk about the state of the election, Representative Judy Chu of California, who was just reelected in an overwhelming majority. Congresswoman Chu, thank you so much for joining us. Got to ask you, first off, with an overwhelming victory for you, curious how you're feeling today, given so many tight races elsewhere.
Well, I have to admit I'm a little bit shell-shocked because a few of my colleagues lost their races. And then Joe Biden is slowly inching towards that 270 electoral votes. But I had hoped that it would have been determined well before now. Nonetheless, I still think that he's facing victory.
Well, President Trump seems to claim the outcome has already been determined. He's already declared victory. He is mounting legal challenges in Michigan and Pennsylvania. What are your biggest concerns about protecting the security of this election?
Well, it is outrageous because every ballot should be counted. And for one thing, every ballot is counted, and they're not all counted on the day of the election. This has been since elections immemorial. In fact, the county registrars have up until a certain time, in this case, December 8th, to certify all the election results and all the ballots. The second thing is that every state has a constitutional right to determine how it counts its ballots. And it's a separate thing for each state. Trump can't order these states to do what he wants them to do, like stop counting, for instance. So I think it's important for us to carry out what is our constitutional duty, and that is to count every ballot that has been dutifully turned in under the expectations that were set out for the voters. And if we do, I think there's a clear path to victory for Joe Biden. And in fact, he just needs at this point Arizona and Nevada in order to reach the magic number of 270.
If former Vice President Biden wins, that means that Kamala Harris, Senator of California, will be vice president. That means that Governor Gavin Newsom will have to appoint someone to replace her who could serve for decades in that seat. What would you like to see him do there?
Well, I would like to see him make sure that we have a well-qualified person. I certainly would like to see somebody that has not been represented before, that is perhaps a person of color. And of course, we had a strong tradition of having women in that position. So I would like to see him have a thorough search and make sure that we have the right person who could lead this state forward. We know that the state has been such a leader in so many ways on combating climate change and in combating COVID. I would like to see that leadership continue on with forward-thinking people in this coming period. So it is a very, very important seat, and I know he'll make the right decision.
Meantime, it looks like Democrats won't win the Senate. The House will keep a Democratic majority, but as you mentioned, a number of colleagues, a number of incumbents lost their seats. How much more difficult does that make your job for the next 4 years, after an already tough 4 years?
Well, it helps tremendously to have the person in the White House be a Democrat. So I think that will help us immensely. And certainly he can do many executive actions that can undo the damage of the past 4 years. I do think, though, that in the Senate, at least the numbers will be closer. Even though we won't have the majority, we will have more than what we had in the past. And I hope that is an incentive for the Senate to be able to be in a negotiating mood so that we can move this country forward. I mean, there are issues that we've had a great deal of common concern over, for instance, the infrastructure of this country. After we deal with COVID, and of course, actually that is my number one issue because we have to make sure that the American people are healthy. We then have to think about how we stimulate this economy, how we get jobs back to the American people. And I think the best way is by having a major infrastructure bill. And we can hit two birds with one stone. If that major infrastructure bill addresses the green economy and makes sure that we have ways of utilizing and enhancing green energy, then we can combat climate change. So I think this is a very important next step. We actually did pass a bill like this just a few weeks ago out of the House, but we also need the Senate to approve it as well. And I hope that with a narrower majority for them, that they will be in a mood to fix these very pressing issues that we have in this country.
All right. Congresswoman Judy Chu of California, thank you so much for joining us and congrats on winning your race. Thank you. All right, coming up, we're going to head back to Wilmington, Delaware for the latest out of Biden campaign headquarters after President Trump declares victory overall and in Pennsylvania. That is next. This is Bloomberg. Former Vice President Joe Biden has taken Michigan and Wisconsin, according to various networks, as ballots continue to be counted in Pennsylvania, Nevada, and beyond. For more on the latest from Biden campaign headquarters, I want to get to Emily Wilkins, who is in Wilmington, Delaware at this moment. Emily, we heard from the former vice president earlier. He said he's not here to claim victory, but believes that after all the votes are counted, that he will win. What is the latest from Biden headquarters at this moment?
So this morning, the Biden campaign sounded very optimistic and confident about what would happen today, and we've seen that confidence play out. Wisconsin has been called for them. Networks are calling Michigan for them. The Biden campaign is still looking at Nevada. The AP has called Arizona for them as well. Look, if Biden can make sure that he has all of those four states locked up, he has 270 electoral college votes, and he will be the next president of the United States.
So what about these legal challenges that President Trump is mounting in various states? How much could that set the Biden campaign back? And what is their response?
So the Trump campaign has so far filed two different lawsuits, one in Michigan and one in Pennsylvania, to stop counting votes. This is something that the Trump campaign kind of implied they might do weeks and weeks back. And the Biden campaign, in response, has lawyered up. They have an army of thousands of lawyers ready to go, ready to meet any of these legal challenges in states. I can't say at this point exactly how it's going to play out in the courts, but both campaigns are ready to potentially take the battle there.
So what does the rest of the night look like for Biden? Will we see him again, or likely not until tomorrow?
Well, at this point, we're looking at Nevada in particular to see if it will be called. Now, the Secretary of State there did say that they're not going to have any results until 9 a.m. on Thursday, so we might not see anything tonight. However, there are a number of other states in play. There's Pennsylvania, there's still Georgia, there's still North Carolina. All of those are very, very thin margins, so we'll be keeping an eye out on those, but there's a chance that we still might not know who the next president of the United States is tonight, and we might not hear from Biden tonight either.
Right. We might not know tonight. We might not know for several days. We might not know for weeks. Okay. Emily Wilkins of Bloomberg Government holding it down for us at Biden headquarters. Thank you so much for that update. I want to stick with the current state of play in the election and bring in Yael Eisenstadt, the former head of elections integrity for political advertising at Facebook and a visiting fellow for Cornell Tech's Digital Life Initiative. Yael, you're also a former CIA officer. You've got a really interesting perspective to add here. As of midnight, Facebook stopped running all social issue, electoral, and political ads in the United States. Do you think that what Facebook is doing in these after hours is enough?
Yeah, it's a great question. I do think Facebook is making a concerted effort to do the right thing, to try to make sure that they do not end up being accused of being a bad actor in this election. In addition to stopping political ads now, which some people don't fully understand why, but it's so that the campaign, particularly Trump campaign, cannot target voters with ads claiming that he is victorious. I think some of the more interesting moves are that they're saying they're using what's called a country at risk type policies. So what that means is that they can take sort of more extreme actions, whether that's labeling posts that are claiming premature victory, or even more concerning, whether it's trying to tamp down any sort of calls to violence, any hate groups that might start speaking up. There's a whole host of things that can happen in the coming days and weeks. And I will say Facebook is taking some good concerted actions, which really comes at the behest of so many academics and activists and journalists and even employees really pushed Facebook to get to this point.
So with the election still in dispute, President Trump threatening legal challenges, what are your biggest concerns at this point? My sources of Facebook have told me they're concerned about civil unrest. They're concerned about violence.
So, yeah, that is definitely one of the biggest concerns. I think you and I spoke a bit about that in August, in fact. We have seen, you know, we've all seen a lot of stoking of emotional, inflammatory rhetoric that, I mean, even during one of the debates, he specifically told the Proud Boys to stand by. And, lots of different groups might interpret that in different ways, but this is where the social media platforms really do have a role to play, because a lot of this activity gets planned on social media, gets stoked, gets amplified. And so one of the concerns is, let's say it is still days or weeks before we fully have an official election result, because don't forget, as long as President Trump does not concede, as long as he does not concede, it is still in play, and we still have to go through the whole electoral college process. So during that time, there's a really big concern that some of these groups, that there have been months or even years of pretty much freely operating on these social media platforms, stoking hatred, stoking division. And now in the 11th hour, Facebook is confronted with, oh my gosh, what do we do now if this really gets sparked? And so it's a really volatile time. I'm not saying that I think that anything horrible is going to happen, but it is volatile, and it is really incumbent on the platforms to do everything they can to not allow things to be organized on their platform, hate groups to start really ramping up hate speech, and even the president of the United States to dog whistle to people to go out and defend his victory or any types of things we can imagine him saying.
Now, leading up to this moment, Facebook also banned things like Holocaust deniers in the weeks leading up to the election, QAnon, the conspiracy theory movement. Interesting to note that a woman named Marjorie Taylor Greene was elected to Congress yesterday, the first, to my understanding, representative who openly supports QAnon. And I'm curious, I know that these movements and conspiracy theories can morph very quickly, but this one now coming into the halls of Congress, what should Facebook and Twitter be doing about that?
So this is where we just have to be frank. They really did too little too late. I mean, for years, it has been just a free-for-all. Conspiracy theorists, all these kinds of groups were not just free to operate on these platforms, but they were being amplified by the algorithms. People were being connected into groups with each other. And there really has been no responsibility for how this has all spread. And now QAnon has become such a widespread phenomenon that I am not certain that the platforms, yes, now they're saying they'll ban QAnon. Facebook, for example, the hashtag Save the Children, they're not letting people, I believe, spread anything with that hashtag. At this point, though, it's become this whack-a-mole game of what do we take down? Who do we take down? And this is where, after this election, we have to get to a point where we take a step back and we say, what is it about these platforms that makes conspiracy theorists and hate groups and all of these organizations thrive? And those are much bigger policy legislation questions that I'm sure we're not going to get into right now, but they're incredibly important. I don't think Facebook and Twitter, I do believe they now finally see that they might need to start acting against these groups, especially because they're afraid that regulation will start coming down if they don't. I don't know how they possibly, though, completely tamp down what's going on with a group like QAnon if they continue with their same business model, which is to prey on our emotions, to prey on our vulnerabilities, to keep us engaged. So it's a huge problem. And as you said, we now have a congresswoman who is she's admit that she is a QAnon follower, supporter, and she is a member of Congress now.
So last quick question, Yael, as we head to break, knowing what we know now, knowing that we can't go back and get a redo, at this point, do you believe that this election will be fair?
I believe it's as fair as it can be up until this moment. I believe if not just the president succeeds in stopping counting the vote, but if he also continues, like if he spurs up, he or his followers, it's not just him, continues to push people like what we're seeing, I think it's in Detroit. I mean, this is all moving so fast. People to go out and physically try to stop people from counting the vote, that's where it's going to get really dangerous. Right at this very moment, it seems like the voting went well, ballots are being counted, you can live stream people of different counties counting votes. It's what happens in the coming hours and days that will determine whether or not it's a fair election.
All right. Yael Eisenstadt, Facebook former head of elections integrity for political advertising. Thank you so much, Yael, for joining us. Really appreciate your perspective there and all the knowledge that you bring to the table. All right, still ahead. China cracks down. Authorities in Beijing are looking to further rein in Jack Ma's Ant Group after abruptly halting its $35 billion IPO. We're going to head to Hong Kong for the latest. This is Bloomberg. The shocking suspension of Ant Group's $35 billion IPO is just the beginning of a renewed campaign by China to rein in the fintech empire controlled by Alibaba founder Jack Ma. And authorities are now setting their sights on Ant's biggest source of revenue. I want to get over now to Stephen Engel, our chief North Asia correspondent in Hong Kong. Stephen, this was a shocking development on the same day as a huge election here in the United States. What is the latest that we know?
You know, there are so many elements to this Ant story and why it was suddenly and abruptly postponed just a couple of days before this record-breaking $34.5 billion dual listing in Shanghai and here in Hong Kong. I mean, the conspiracy theorists are out, not just in the United States for the election, but here on this as well. Was this simply a matter of regulation and that the authorities want to, you know, put in tougher regulation on fintech and in particular on Ant, as it has grown much further beyond just its Alipay payment system, but to credit and lending and being a facilitator between banks, traditional banks, and consumers, and then allegedly, according to regulators, charging a higher fee for those being the intermediary while the big state-owned banks take on all the risk. That's one side of it. Or is it a bigger issue? Has Jack Ma grown too big? Has Alibaba, has Ant Financial grown too big? He's China's richest man, right? He has so far stayed kind of safe. I mean, 3 years ago, I interviewed Jack Ma and I asked him, how do you get close to the fire without getting burned? And he said, we have to be very careful. Is this the party, Xi Jinping in particular, flexing his muscles as Victor Scher at the University of California, San Diego? Is that what's happening, or is it more on a regulatory front? We have to kind of dig deeper, but I think all of the above.
Right. It's certainly fascinating given how successful and how much wealth and attention Jack Ma has brought to China. Curious for your thoughts, given the frost that has fallen on U.S.-China relations under President Trump. What does a potential change in administration mean for U.S.-China relations or Trump remaining in the White House?
That's a big million-dollar question, right? I mean, so many people are questioning, who would China prefer? Obviously, it would be less cantankerous, perhaps, with Joe Biden in as the president. We know that, you know, kind of Donald Trump has thrown the kitty into the puppy pound and seen what kind of turmoil can cause. And, you know, upending the apple cart as far as the U.S.-China relationship on trade and other areas. But at the same time, perhaps the Chinese leadership likes what Donald Trump has done in deteriorating the alliances, the post-war alliances that we've seen with Western democracies post-World War II. So you never know. But one thing I am sure, and as you probably know, you were a China correspondent. I was the China correspondent for 7 years. They watch this stuff very closely.
Absolutely. We see U.S. politics covered in Chinese state-run media as well. I'm sure you're reading all of that. Bloomberg's Stephen Engel for us in Hong Kong. Stephen, thanks so much for giving us the view from the other side of the Pacific. And that does it for this edition of Bloomberg Technology. Stay tuned. We've got all of the election covered, what's happening in various states. You can also follow us live streaming on Twitter. Check us out at Technology. And follow our global breaking news network, Quick Take, on Twitter as well. More of Bloomberg Television after this break.